So, the systemic approach. When I started with the systemic approach, I was still a clinician, and it was systemic family therapy. So over years, we did family therapy with psychiatric families, anorexia and things like that. And we learned our techniques from the Milan group, Mara Selvini Palazzoli, and others in that field. So at Zen, the idea was mainly to work with systems instead of individuals. So not thinking the sick one is a person, and the behavior is only related to the internal organization of that person and to the biography of that person. By then, the focus changed and say nobody can act crazy without others helping him. So it's always a system interacting with others that is maintaining strange behavior. And certainly it's always a system, an interacting system with others in order to develop more healthy behavior or more functional behavior. So we learned to look at the interaction instead of the characteristics of a person and the history of that characteristics. And for years we did systemic family therapy. But today when I use the term systemic, we call it from the coaching association, it's a container term. There are many perspectives that go together under the label systemic, and I will give some explanations on our perspectives. So it's not, systemic is not in working with systems to look at organizations, at families, at communities as a system. This is true as well, but it's also an attitude, a systemic approach to the world. So it's a perspective more than understanding a community as a system, the system. And I want to outline that a bit. So in this container we have several perspectives. One is, and this is certainly not due to you. So many of the systemic ideas are not new. Many of them are thousands of years old. But they need to be outlined right now because at least our Western cultural tradition has developed an idea of attributes of individuals or of organizations and forgetting there's always somebody who is saying this is how it is. So the model how we understood, for example, organizations was a mechanical model. It was like a big watch, and we had to organize the structure in a good way, and then we make the structure into a function, and if the it is structured well, it will hopefully function well. So it was a mechanical, technical understanding of organizations. And different is coming from biology and from other sciences, the idea no, organizations are living systems. It's not a mechanic. And it's very complex, and complex means you do not really, you never will really understand how it functions. There will always be something you did not yet understand. It has its own logic and its own life, and you can always be surprised. So complex doesn't mean complicated. Something can be complicated, but totally controllable. Complex means you learn to deal with things with an attitude that you know something, but you never know enough. Gregory Bateson, who was one of the mental fathers of this perspective, has put it in a metaphor. He said, if you have a soccer ball, football, and you can calculate exactly how you kick it, then you can calculate exactly how it will fly and where it will land. If this is a dog, it's different. And so this is meaning dealing with living systems, and your spouse always can be a dog, not a football, and your boss, and your employee, and your partner. And this gives up a different attitude, that we can learn something, try out, and what works, works, but it's not because it is that way, it's only because it works so far that way. And if it will work no longer, then we have to find out how we can change our trials to deal with it, to learn different heuristics to deal with it, and never believe that you really understand what's happening. So that's a different attitude. And some use the terms over-complex and under-complex. If you deal with a management problem, and it's just complex because there are so many influences causing the effects you are experiencing. If you then have a simple explanation, this is why, and what we then can do is the following. Then you develop an under-complex solution pattern. And most likely, this solution pattern will not function or not be secure enough. So you have to develop a different attitude. What is complex enough? That we have enough factors that we can deal with the thing sufficiently. This does not mean that we understand anything. So, what I said already from family therapy is we learned more to look at patterns of relatedness than of attributes of things. For example, in family therapy, the question is the boy gets a tender tantrum? Then we do not ask, what do you think, what was the internal process of that boy that led to this temper tantrum? We asked, what will happen then in the room? Mother will cry, and when mother will cry, father will come in. And if there is no temper tantrum, father will not come in. So we can have the idea that the temper tantrum is related with making mother cry, making father come in. So then you have different ideas what you can do about the temper tantrum. If you have different ways to make father come in, then maybe it doesn't make sense to have more temper tantrums. So you have different kinds of hypotheses, how things interrelate, and you have different points where you try to effect a difference in the system. This is the metaphor of the mobile. That is, mobile is the word you know, that's a sculpture that's in the air, and it's...
Kinetic art.
What's the name?
Kinetic art.
You said
it's moving, right?
Yeah. And you study how things are moving, and when you tip at one point, you make an intervention, and then you watch what will happen. Are there mechanism to very soon bring the system into the old interrelatedness, or are there points where there's a lot of change, and the change is getting even exaggerated, And small impact produces a lot of change, and there are points where a lot of impact produces very little change. And this is that we learned to understand interrelatedness, to understand how where we can intervene. Yeah, this is was coming from, for example, from family therapy. What came more from biology, Maturana, Varela, the Chilean scientists who made new maps of that reality is always the reality of the subject that is experiencing reality. So if you want to deal with reality, you should include the observer, the one for whom this reality is relevant. I remember when I taught it 30 years ago, I always used the metaphor of the frog. The frog has a fixed eye, so the frog only information, the systemic information term is a difference. It makes a difference. So because the frog has a fixed eye, the frog only can detect moving things. So a fly that is not moving for a frog is not a fly. It starts to be a fly when it's moving. And then all the mechanism to jump for it can be activated. Or we had the term, I taste sweet in contact with sugar, because tasting sweet is an attribute of my sensus apparatus and not of sugar. If I don't have this kind of sensus apparatus, then sugar is not sweet. So we learn to understand that it should always be an observer included when you try to describe reality, especially when you want to do interventions afterwards to change reality. Then you have to think about whose reality and for whom would what change be what. And because you don't know all this in advance, in complex living systems, there are so many perspectives on reality, you cannot map all these perspectives. This is why you need to dialogue. And usually the other people are not aware that they have a perspective. They think it's just natural. So everybody has to learn to understand that your worldview is your worldview. It's not natural. It must not be that way. And this leads to a different attitude in working with communication and relating to the world. This is a reality constructivist perspective. Attitudes, going along with this label systemic, we have some new attitudes coming from that. One is respect. That's not new. Not these are not the systemic people who invented that. But it's a consequence of understanding it is complex, and I know very little how reality is from the perspective of others. And the others have as good reasons for their view on reality as I have. So it's not only an emotional attitude, it's an understanding why I should have this attitude. Otherwise, I have no chance really to take in consideration the necessary perspectives when I want to solve a problem, for example. Then this is making a difference to the classical clinical approach. So not the clinical approach, we learned pathologies and what to do about pathologies. So we described people as pathological people. And this always is calling for producing schemata, because sane people are very difficult to describe, and there are no patterns you can include them. So we learned to take some distance from describing systems in their pathology, because the pathology are only the repetitive patterns, and the more repetitive they are, they are more likely not functional. But to describe systems in non-repetitive patterns. So, and not saying there are mistakes that have to be straightened out, or there are neurotic reactions that have to be healed, but more thinking about how is this a resource? What resources do people have? And how can we develop these resources and they lose interest in being pathological? And let's not think too much about problems, let's think about solutions. My colleague Gunther Weber, who is an international known family therapist, he always said, you need to have, if you know how you drove your car into the mud, you don't know how you will get it out. And we are interested, what do we have to know to find a way to get it out? And we are not so much interested, how did we drive it into the mud? So it's a change in direction of attention. And this also leads to curiosity. That's the attitude, most likely do not know. And I'm an expert in professionally not knowing. So this means I know how to ask people, I know how to think about whom to ask, I know about focusing what will we need to understand and who will know something about what we need to understand. And certainly we have a lot of experience and models in the background, and sometimes we can use them to recognize something. But they stay in the background. And we learn to be curious in an educated way. And we learn to be experimental. So this is very important in companies. So we think about when we want to have maybe a better functioning team, we do not use too much time to analyze the team. We analyze it a bit, then we have a hypothesis. What could make a difference? And then we set up an experiment that brings this difference into a life, and we look whether it functions or not. And when it functions in a satisfied way, it's fine. And we do not insist that we did have the right explanation. We had a useful explanation that helped us to do a good experiment. And that's all. So we give up the notion of we have to know why exactly. But then we cannot do any experiment. We have limited resources. So we have to learn to build up a culture in discussing what kind of experiments can we make. And we can make controlled experiments and learn from the experience we gain through an experiment. And so a learning culture is prepared with these kind of attitudes. So, and it's quite obvious that every complex job includes a lot of learning. You have some schemata, but in the real case, it's always different. So I always say you can start stupid, that's no problem, as long as you learn quickly. So it's not the art of knowing everything when you start, but the art of learning very quickly while you move forward. And so you can very early start to do something, but always combined with a setting and an attitude of learning and understanding what you learn, that you do wise experiments and not just something. So complex jobs have a big learning part. Every organizational development, I will say more about these things, has to be combined with a learning culture on the focus on the organizational development. And there should be resources and space for that. This is mostly neglected. They somehow try to do a change. And a change will have more chances if you have a mature learning culture in the organization. Then you start somewhere and you learn very quickly. And it's not an individual learning alone, it's also a learning of a system. So you need a culture of how you play together while learning. And this does not happen naturally. This has to be built up. So I said that already. So we are, when I do a coaching session with somebody, I try to understand what the reality is the person is living in, from the way the person talks, from the way the person reacts, from the way, what does the person put in the foreground, what does the person put in the background, what would I do in the foreground, but is totally neglected by that person. So I study the way a person is at each point reconstructing her or his frame of reference and inviting into others to share that frame of reference. We all have techniques to invite others into our own craziness. And we are very good at that, usually. And if you have treated psychotics, as we did for a long time, you know that they are better than you are. If you don't have a very solid system behind you, they are more competent to draw you into the psychotic system than you are competent to to draw them out of the psychotic system in a frame of reference of somehow normal functioning. So it's a process how we reenact reality by communication, how we do that internally, which part of us are involved in that process, what are our patterns, how do we limit ourselves. This is all internally, but you also can do it externally. And so I'm a transactional analyst as well, and this is an excellent school where you can study how people transaction by transaction, communication unit by communication unit, create reality and invite others into sharing that reality. And within a very short time, a culture is created and everybody thinks that this is how it should be. It's natural. But it's created. And not forget that it's created, and this means it can be created different at any point. But it's not easy to create it differently because there are so many habitual reflexes that draw you back into your habitual understanding of reality. That's an art to create new realities. And this is important for not only for personal development, it's also important for organizational development. So, and this means that we need, if we want to study how that happens, we need other concepts. We need concepts on perspectives. What kind of perspective this person is acting from. In TA we learned that from ego states. The ego state has a specific perspective. When organizational work, it's more the question, what job has this person in the organization? On what position is that person? What organizational role does that person have? At what point in his or her career is that person? Because this gives you an understanding of the important perspective for this person, and then you can dialogue with this person on what could matter for this person, if you want to involve this person in a cooperation process. And if you have any ideas how to solve a problem, we learned to see what does this include. For example, my discussion with Bert Hellinger on the constellation. Is Bert Hellinger known here? Is a person who is working with, oh, if somebody does not know anything about that, it's not easy to explain. The power fields of the own biography and soul are made visible by standing in a room and having people standing for the one or the other part, and then you rearrange the system. And you do it, and Bert Hellinger is doing it coming from psychological or esoteric principles. And he was working with high boards of companies with that. And they were impressed, and it really changed a lot within the company. But the implications, and this was what I criticized him for, is that this is a way how you can run a company, to find out about all these power fields. And say, if they as a leader adopt this idea, what should they do with their employees when they want to discuss with them a problem? Also do a constellation like this? So, also, the consequences are interesting. The implications are, this is how we do it and how we understand the world and what counts in this world. And the implications, I think, are destructive. Also, some of the consequences in specific cases may be very intriguing. So we learn to think about it. What kind of reality are you introducing when you use this or that method, or introduce this or that frame of reference? And if people adopt this frame of reference, what kind of consequences will this have? For example, if you do a team developmental work and you always work with motivation and how can I get a good relation to somebody on a psychological level, you forget totally that whether a team functions or not has to do with the logic of their roles and the positions in the organization. And this is an implication if you work only on a psychological level, that this is what rules organizations. And this is not true. And the consequences are people start to think in how can I be a better psychologist instead of how can I better understand what a leader has to do in this kind of organization, having this power, having this knowledge, having this kind of cooperation partners. So it's changing the world in which I try to act. And it's a mental thing, it's an observer's thing, it's not natural. So this is point four, I've already explained. And one of the models we use in training is this triangle of complexity management. So if you, for example, as a consultant in an organization wants to do something, as a supervisor, I cannot tell you what is the right way to do it. I ask you, what is your understanding of the problem? For example, there are always in teams there are always the secretary always has a nervous breakdown. When the coach is saying, my understanding is that the secretary has a hard time in life, and this is why she is not fit. And from time to time, it then just happens because of something that happens in the family, what we don't know. So we have to send her for family therapy. So if you understand the situation, the observation as a problem like this, then your client system is a secretary, and you understand her being mainly in her private orientation that somehow is lived out in a professional environment. And then you go down. This means your professional action is psychotherapy. And the one who has to do something with her, has to choose the role of a psychological counselor, family counselor, or psychotherapist. And this may define his or her strategies according to the school the person is belonging to and methods she or he chooses. But if you have the same situation with the secretary and you say, oh, the boss of the secretary is absent so much, and he tells her she should rule the team, but she doesn't have the power. She doesn't have the right to give commands to anybody. And then if there is a specific stress on the team, everybody does something that is serving himself or herself, but not so much cooperation in the team and solving the challenge as a whole. Then the secretary feels responsible to help with that. And then she goes to everybody and tries to be nice and cute and finds all private functioning relationship maneuvers to invite people into staying together responsible. But this is not enough, or it's so exhausting that she gets a nervous breakdown. If you state the same problem like this, you would not say she is a client. You say the team is a client, or she and her boss, the relationship is a client. When you say she doesn't dare to refuse his responsibility and tell him, I will not be there if you are not there in these stress situations. Then you decide, okay, we try to take a part of the problem by stating it this way. Then we invite, when the boss calls us, we should treat the secretaries. We tell him, why not trying to come with her together, and we treat you as a couple, but not a private couple, but a boss and secretary couple. And then I choose, the client system is not the secretary, but it's secretary and boss. And it's a different environment, and I look at them in their organizational roles, not in their private roles. So the personal private history does not play a major role in this kind of discussion. So we try to find out why the boss, how his reality is, that he thinks he can neglect to be attentive if there is stress on the team. Does he have a map, understanding when that happens and what this has to do with a specific market situation or workload situation in the company? And if he thinks this is the case, does he have an understanding of his role, what he should do? Does he have the competence to do it? Does he have the time to do it? What will his boss say when he changes attentions that way? Or is it a cultural system in his company not to look at problems in this way? So, and then certainly you do not use individual consulting techniques. You use relationship consulting techniques, and you use frame of references for that which are related to organizational roles. And you do not need a biography-oriented psychotherapy training to do so, because there are many, many questions you can ask that helps them to understand what the relation is about and what they could change. So this is how to deal with a dog, not with a football. So you decide how you look at it. And the way you look at it, then you try to create an experiment where you can try to understand something and change something and see what happens then. So it's a learning design. It's not a diagnose solution design. And it's a learning design for everybody, because boss and secretary have to learn something, and you I have more the role of setting the learning setting up and helping them to learn. And this requires that you are a person who understands him or herself as being a learning specialist for and understanding learning styles of others in specific contexts. And this is a change in professional identity. So this is a triangle of complexity management. So this makes very clear that at each point you have to decide on these three edges of the triangle. And you can start from each, and you have habits and preferences at each edge of the triangle, and you can, if your habits work, why not? But if they don't work, then you have options to think. And very often professionals are not integrated. They think, for example, the contract is I have to do a communication training with the secretary, but they have been on a workshop with Bernd Schmid and they start to think, oh, this is delegation power and this has to do with the relationships between her boss and the other bosses at the neighbor departments. And then he has a lot of wonderful ideas, neglecting that he has neither the contract, nor the role, nor the competence to act on this kind of stating the problem. So if this is a way I understand the problem, then I should find somebody who has access to these people to influence them and is competent to do so. If I only can do communication trainings, then I can find out with whom can I do something with this perspective and is it acceptable enough to do so. Also, there may be instances that are just neglected that way and it might be an endless story to do communication training and fixing again. So this triangle represents a challenge to a more complex understanding of your self-control as professional. And this is a, I told you that all my concepts I developed out of practical situations.
Maybe we could check what they are getting because I don't know whether they are getting the concepts.
Yeah.
How they are framing it in their mind.
Okay.
So just to check once.
Okay.
And then align maybe will be helpful.
Okay. Gisen reminds me that I should act on my ideas of dialoguing. the question is to ask you whether you have the feeling that you understand something or what I'm saying, and you can certainly not everything when it's new to you, but get a sense of how this inspires you or you can integrate these ideas in your own ideas. Where are you?
I need more clarity because I feel it very vague. What you're presenting, I'm able to understand.
Yes.
But not very precisely.
Oh, yes, sure.
If they have said some examples.
Oh, yeah, I tried to give you the example with the secretary and the boss. Was this clear?
Do you gave.
Yes.
It was understandable.
Yeah.
I don't know how to express that.
Yeah.
Each one, I just wanted it as specified separately,
to
be understandable for us.
Okay, I'm not sure whether I can do that because this is a lot to teach. I told you that we have a 2 years program to do so. is there something specific what you wanted to ask more? Maybe I can give you a part of it and do an example?
No, I'll come to you separately. Suppose if everybody is comfortable, then
okay.
I think it's a bit abstract.
Yeah, it is abstract.
Yeah, so I don't know how realistic it is to actually try and make it a bit more real life or, you know, some real life examples. I don't know whether that'll work.
Yeah.
And if you think it's a 2 year program and we're trying to cram it in 3 days, probably should we re-look at it and just say we just take a subsection of it and make sure we understand, this might,
yeah,
others might differ, but I just find it a bit abstract,
yeah,
to understand, and I don't know how you solve that problem.
Yeah, it is abstract, you are right.
Yes.
This means I tried to, from thousands of practical situations, there are principles,
sure,
abstracted.
Sure.
And I tried to give you an understanding of a design of different principles, how we approach concrete situations. What it would not work when I try to at any point to do an example. But if we only, this is a kind of dilemma, if we only select a section, I can do that, but I don't know, then you will not have the overview. So we have to decide somehow. What I usually do and what works usually quite fine is after having just a lecture like this, having a demonstration of a consultation, a practical issue. Somebody of you brings in and I try and I show you how as a consultant deal with that. And I never know in advance which concepts will then be important, but I show you in practice how I deal it. Usually this fills the need of feeling how it works.
That's exactly right. I guess that's my point. So I think if we do that session,
okay,
I think what the abstract concepts would make sense when we actually implement.
Okay, yes.
I have a suggestion.
Pardon?
I have a suggestion.
Yes.
The characteristics of each perspective that you are explaining now can be a little bit of a simple definition. May not, that's okay, I think I'm quite audible. May not be followed by examples, but then that explanation of each perspective could be in a very simple thing. Otherwise, it looks, we are not able to relate.
Yeah. That's a problem with the definitions.
Maybe it's not a real time thing, so we are not able to relate.
Yeah. I understand the problem to relate, and I try to deal with that. I'm not refusing that. But I do not believe that it's working by definition. I'm a follower of Steiner, who is an anthropologist, who is saying defining means clarifying the borders of the meaning of something. But it's only clarifying the limitations. It's not giving you a sense about the essentials of it. And I try to give the essentials by talking around it and giving some examples that you get a feeling of how it is. And it could not be replaced by a classical definition. He says, definitions of the way we are used to it are good for science, but he calls it, how is the English term, kernprägnant, core understanding definition, that you grasp the meaning of it. And you cannot do this by indicating the limitations. So,
May I have a session?
Yeah, come. Please come here.
It's like, let's say you started with systemic perspective. Bernd started with systemic perspective. It'll be good maybe to take some feedback on what did they understand as systemic perspective? What is their frame of reference about it?
Okay.
So that there is a shared frame of reference in the beginning. Then building over it, maybe will be easier from there.
Okay.
At this moment, I see that that connection, if it is established, then her point of being related and connected will happen on its own. So that's my sense.
I hope so. I would be glad if, yes.
Would you? Okay, so say, let's say he talked about systemic perspective. So this was the first slide he started with. So what is your understanding at this moment? Maybe we just take 5 minutes.
Please.
To ask you about what is your understanding of systemic perspective? And if you want to really make it interactive, then you really have to gear up now. If you ask low, then Bernd has a lot of information, tons and tons of information. you just have to come out and push yourself to ask what you want. So what is your understanding of systemic perspective right now?
I had difficulty in following the full course of his speech.
Okay.
I had difficulty in grasping whatever that was said, and I had a huge difficulty.
Okay, so what will help you?
So we are curious to
probably the complexities of the issues that are being discussed here is completely new to certain people, who are possibly not exposed to coaching or training aspects.
Okay.
I am not from that field, so possibly it's a bit more difficult for me.
So if it is, will be helpful if you have some live examples from your life?
Yeah.
And then to connect that to what he talks.
Now, one is that, and second is the probably little less use of, those specific terms associated with psychological training or whatever. I mean, we are not very familiar with it.
Okay.
That kind of.
So maybe the terms like psychotherapy, clinical orientation, they are not familiar at all.
So one thing, sir, I think actually everyone has a perception.
Just a minute.
Yeah, everyone has a perception.
Yes.
Because we are curious to know.
Okay.
Like what his side of that, the explanation about that. And how far you are aligned to that? That is what personally I'm looking forward to.
Okay. It will happen. It's all going to happen now. We are open to that kind of
Sir, excuse me, sir. The main perspectives are given like this: systemic approach, sharing realities and learning, leadership and performance. Just if you take the first three, I'm not taking everything.
Okay.
If you first to take these three, I think it is not correlating with the one with the other. When you go for the steps, you want to reach a point.
So what I understand is, first let's take this 3 point.
Yes.
Take some time to understand on that. And then?
Then go for, there is no aim at all. There is no aim, there is no final solution to reach that.
Okay.
So you must give the first aim.
Okay.
See, okay. What we are going to see. Then the steps should follow that to reach that.
I understand.
Here I can find there is no relation between each and everything. Is something?
But those are separate subjects altogether. They're not correlated.
Okay.
So that's not correlated. Even though we must have a single goal.
It
is going on.
I'm just coming back. See, this comes from a particular frame of reference of our learning, that there has to be a definition and there is a structured way of learning. That is our syllabus-oriented learning. But where Bernd will be bringing is more of a rich experience of so much of experience gathered over a period of time. So slightly be open for dialogical process. But what I sense will be helpful is, at any point if you're not understanding or you want a clarity, please take charge and ask for it at that moment. That will be like what he talks about. The system is not about what he is talking, but how we are interacting with him. Maybe that part is what is missing. So if you feel like, yes, I have a doubt and I don't have a clarity, maybe asking about it at that point of time will help. What do you think, Bernd?
We can try.
What I am saying, thinking is, Bernd, maybe initially we go slow.
Yes.
But once that alignment has happened, then maybe the speed will automatically increase.
Yeah. I'm not in a hurry.
Yeah. So.
Okay.
Yeah, but then only if you understand the concept, you can ask questions based on it, right?
If you're not understanding, then the first step itself to ask that. Like, for example, your question now is, okay, I have to understand the concept to even frame a question.
Exactly.
If there is a doubt in the concept, then stop there.
So would you be able to frame to us what is systemic?
Yeah, Bernd will do that. I'm not supposed to do that. Bernd will do it, certainly. But what I'm saying is, at any point, he will see what is simple to you will be very different to what is simple to him. So that is the whole dialogical process is, we all have our own frame of reference with which we will observing what he is talking. So somewhere I see that what I am actually talking about is what Bernd talked about. In an organization, we need to create a space where there can be a dialoguing happening. And I'm just inviting him to create the same space here so that the dialogic also happens. But the difficulty we have yesterday, because I was discussing with him on how he wants to orient the program, he has brought a lot of information and he wants to share that information with you. And then in between there will be examples also. But you need to also be ready to go to that level. I'm somewhere feeling, sitting there and watching, that there is a missing link. That's the reason I stepped in. I didn't want to do it later, but at that point of time. So what I would invite is, maybe till lunch, we ground ourselves together, align ourselves together, and then maybe go faster, is my thinking.
Do we have lunch now at 12:30?
Yeah, 12:30.
Okay. We changed that in advance, 12. Not one. So that.
May I suggest something?
Yes.
Because what I'm experiencing is the struggle in not only the learning styles, but also the the level of competence in terms of the audience in matching. Because as you said, you are coming from a meta abstract perspective, whereas many of us here probably are still in a very concrete learning
processes. Base, yes.
And also there is, I think, a mismatch in terms of comprehension of even sometimes the words itself because of the cultural differences.
Yes.
So my invitation would be for you, having worked with Bernd and also being part of our culture, if you could maybe summarize some significant parts of it. Can you translate what?
See, there are two ways we can do now. What I see is, I have to check with Bernd that now it's a drama stage and he's been in the limelight. And is it okay if I share the stage with you for a while?
Yes.
And if
certainly.
You can share play and then maybe we co-play together.
Yeah, I'm glad if you do that. Because I want to give you whatever I can give, but right now I seem to meet some limits, and I'm glad for everything that helps to overcome these limits.
Okay. Thanks for sharing that idea. I'm just coming, Trish. I'm just coming. So, if it is okay, then from the systemic perspective, we both co-play together for a while, and this is one thing which we also invite in organization is our ability to co-play. Like one of the concepts of Bernd is to always see a reality construction as a drama stage. Like if you set a stage, particular scene will happen on its own. So here at this drama stage, we are willing to co-play for a while. Okay. So I have a question from Chris, so I take that and then maybe talk about systemic perspective, my understanding, and then Bernd also co-plays along with me. And then we start from there. Is it okay, Bernd?
You yes.
Have to go two steps back from where you are now.
Two.
Okay.
So I think my question, Bernd, is that when I come in, I come in with the background of both being a small-time entrepreneur and as a coach. So my personal struggle is I'm like, okay, what's going to happen for me in 3 days' time? I know I'm going to learn concepts. So what's your vision for me as a coach, as an entrepreneur, learning your concepts? What do you think is going to happen for me, or what do you think is going to be the goals we will achieve? I mean, there are learning goals, but I'm looking at what would be the behavioral change goals and the way of working, what would be the kind of results we would be looking at, what is it the kind of changes you're looking for in the consultants in the room? So I'm kind of grappling with that, you know. So one thing that I definitely got was that you were saying that the personal biography is not important in the organizational work. So I was quite curious about that. So I did want to ask you some questions. But my first thing is, what's your goal for us? You know, what is it that you want us to go with at the end of 3 days in terms of changes or the way we work or the way we think? So that's what my main question is at this point.
Okay, this is one question maybe I will take it at this moment, but.
Yeah.
See, this is the same question with which every organization starts, what is your goal? And that is very difficult to define a goal in an organization. That is one perspective from a private orientation to moving to an organizational orientation itself to fix the goal. Because when you fix the goal, we are not able to see reality for what it is. Because unless we know the reality, then the goal emerges. But when we put the goal first, then that is a colored glass we are already wearing. And this is the same struggle I had as a psychotherapist, as a person who is more individual oriented when I started working with the organization. And the organization were also asking the same question, how do I now go towards a goal? But what we forgot is, how do we set a culture where these goals can be achieved? So that part was missing, and that's what Bernd helped me to look into. So this is a perspective change. And that's a good question, because this is an exact perspective of an organization itself. What's my goal? What's my goal? How do I achieve it? The targets. But we don't set a culture for it.
Like, the question is, what are the goals, right? It's not, he's not asking how are we going to achieve the goals.
Yeah.
His question is, what are the goals? See, every company, every organization needs to have vision. It needs to have a direction.
Yes.
You know, how you get there evolves over time. And I understand the concept of the lean startup, and you know, you're trying to do small things at a time. You're learning from what you do.
Yeah.
And then you evolve, you try something else, and there's active evolving.
Yes.
But you've got direction that you're heading towards, right? What is that?
Yes, that's where, if you see, it's an experimental approach.
Okay.
We frame a hypothesis, this may be the goal, and then we go towards that. That's where Bernd said the topic, it's okay to start even stupid, but as long as you're able to quickly learn something in the due course.
Okay.
Okay, so it's an experimental approach by itself, which we need to be ready for. Because that experimental approach gives you a space for something to emerge. To have a common sense perspective onto what's happening there.
So I guess the what we
the overall goal, since he asked, I would say, just taking on behalf of it's building learning culture.
Right.
Because just learning as styles is different from building a culture for learning. And how do we do that in organization is a specialization.
Right.
Okay, that is the overall goal. But how do we do that? That's what he said. It doesn't happen as a natural process. You need to create it. So what are the steps? How to do that? What are the challenges we may face in the process? All those things are the methods.
Makes sense.
Okay. So this will be the overall goal.
And there is not one version of all that. So it has to be defined for each concrete situation specifically. And so I cannot teach you what are typical steps, goals, solutions, way to behave. What I can say is how can we, what attitudes do we need and what procedures, for example, work to come together to find out together specifically what in this case is the right thing to do. So build up a dialogue culture. And I personally, I'm not so much in front of goal, because a goal is a point on the line into future. I'm more and this is part of the way of culture I try to introduce. It's more defining direction and how we move there. And then we think about what direction do we prefer and what direction do we leave now and try a different experiment, and how can we set up learning experience to begin to understand in which direction we are on the way now and what helps us to be in on our way successfully, and then reaching of goals will somehow come out, but most often you reach something else than you defined as a goal before, except it's only a goal in terms of numbers. And this is your experience, I guess, certainly. So it's a question of mindset, how you approach that.
So the question was, when Bernd started about systemic approach, what is your understanding of systemic approach? Maybe one or two of you share your thinking on systemic approach, particularly entrepreneurs, educationalists, what is your thinking, professionals? Did you get the term systemic approach? Yeah,
Krishna. There are two two aspects. Organizations are always...
Please, first the microphone. Okay.
So what I grasped, I come from an engineering background. So for me, system engineering is something that which evolved 15 years ago in system engineering. So I was trying to correlate. And the synopsis, what I heard from Bernd is, organizations are like mechanical systems. Okay, mechanical systems doesn't have life. But there is another aspect which is called biological. So it is very easy to predict a mechanical behavior because it's a set method in which you give an input and then the output comes. He gave an example. You hit a soccer ball in certain method, it reaches the destination in a certain way, it's predictable. But then when we have to attach that to the systemic, when you want to kick a dog, it will behave in a very erratic way. That means organization has a mechanical element, but there are a lot of biological elements which are human, and we have to deal them in a different way. So that's how I correlated that. How do you handle this as a systemic approach? It's very, very different. Why? Because there are many attitudes, he said. Many attributes, he said. One is communication, attitude of the people, complexity, patterns, and so on. That's the way I have inferred.
That's a wonderful understanding, I would say. You also agree with that?
Yes, that's what I wanted to convey.
That's a very, very wonderful understanding that the system can be seen as a mechanical model, where if you move this, certainly this will happen. Like for example, if I throw a stone with so much of energy, it will reach there. But if I have to throw a pigeon, I don't know whether it will go that place. Maybe if I just release it, it will just fly away and go. So organization is a combination of both. So you cannot just push for targets and say, if you do these efforts, you're going to get this out as an outcome. It never happens that way. But what Bernd was talking about is when it is not happening, as external interventions, when we went into organization, we started asking about personal biography of people, saying that what's going on in your mind for this not to happen. But in a systemic approach, we see how the interaction is happening between people, which could be a better intervention rather than getting into a personal orientation of the personality of the person, but how they interact with each other. Like for example, if I have to tell you, like if something is not happening well in an organization, like he said about the secretary and the boss, the secretary is panicking because now the boss is expecting her to handle the team but not giving enough responsibility and power to take a decision. So if you go now and deal with the secretary and try to coach her or tell her that you can do something different, it's not going to happen. The systemic approach is that the responsibility is not shared properly, the decision powers are not shared properly. So we need to see how the interaction is happening between many parts in the system for you to understand what's happening in that system. This is my input at this point of time. Maybe Bernd want to add a little more.
No, it was perfect.
So now I'm getting a sense of system. So when he's talking about, yeah.
I just also want to share skills. So my understanding here is, I'm a mechanical engineer basically, and I also done my MBA. So
would you like to stand up?
Yeah. My understanding.
Yeah.
Okay. So my understanding is, I'm working for an organization, and since I'm a mechanical engineer, I know, if I program something, 1, 2, 3 step, and then I get an output. To get that output, I have a lot of people in the organization who has to do that, and then they are forced to get the output. But what we communicate to that person to get that output, because machines or systems does not make any mistake. When we start in a point and we get an output out. Still we get errors, we see that we don't achieve the target. I think there is a gap between the way we communicate to those people who actually do that, make that process to happen. So I think that's the perception that we need to see to change, and that's what I think this program, I'm going to learn in this program is what I feel. So how we communicate the message to the people to make that right. So that's my understanding.
Yeah, it's one about communication. I think Bernd will be talking more about communication as a model in organizational context itself. It's about one communication, another is how this communication is interacted between many people. Like, for example, I will give you one sentence of my experience when I'm working in a systemic perspective is, in an organization, let's say there are repeated mistakes. You correct it, and over a period of time, again, you see the same mistake is happening. And sometimes I have seen the same mistake happening for 10 years in the same organization. We don't know how it is getting sustained so beautifully. Have you seen that? You have gone through some disturbance at some point of time, but it is repeated again and again and again and again. Why it is happening? I found one simple culture in the organization is we are supposed to talk of what we are asked to do, but we are not supposed to talk about what we did not do. There are many things when we were asked to do, certain things the organization employees were not able to do, but there was not enough time given to ask, okay, you did all these things wonderfully, but maybe when you did this, you did not do something. Maybe they did not have enough resources or time for that, or they were not asked how they can, when they are asked to do this, what they are going to do with the previous work. So that part was missing. So that is a systemic process. We just addressed that part, where every day the manager said, okay, today you talk about whatever you did, when all you were not able to do. Just by taking that into account, the entire thing changed. So here we don't work in terms of an individual orientation, but how the culture is prevailing in an organization for people to behave in a particular way. So this is one example of a systemic process. To have one next and keep talking, what I
no,
think.
No, 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 it's wonderful. I'm only here once, so you will be here later.
Not one. One is that, and another is what I'm talking is most probably or firmly the learnings I have heard with him. It's a wonderful learning process. The first time when I met him in Oxford, 3 days, I certainly did not understand much. But I know this man had something he is having. So I contacted him. It was a very strong decision between myself, a struggle between Anu and myself, because Anuradha is the one who's the co-director of my organization. When I finished Oxford visit, when I was thinking of Bernd, his charges I heard from other people is 500 euros per hour. But I don't know whether he will do that. I don't know whether I will be able to afford that, because 500 euros per hour is a big money for us. So I had a courage, I had a discussion, and I told her, even if he's going to ask that 500 euros, I'm going to learn from that man. He didn't know that. These were the things which I was going through before I called him. So I just called him and he gave me 1 hour session on my issue. Where I was working with an organization where people were quitting jobs very regularly. Attrition was very high. So it was one thing which I made as an intervention is, I said, the people in the lower level who are leaving the organization are not given importance. And I came with a psychological perspective on these people are given a perspective of they are not important at all, they are not valued. Who has to give them the value? Bernd asked. Then I told, maybe those senior managers, they have to do that. So I am talking to the senior managers also. So he asked me, do the senior managers and the lower level managers talk together? I said, no. Then make them do it. I did not make so much of an intervention on my own self. So I have to just make them talk together. And then things changed. So it was just a common sense perspective which Bernd gave me at many different times. And then when I spoke to him, he said he has earned enough and he is not going to take any money from me for teaching me. But one condition he brought in over a period of time is to write what he taught me so that many more people can benefit out of it. So I wrote every tape which we had and then sent those verbatims word by word which I wrote back to him, changed in my thinking and then got his perspective And this was a 3 years continuous work. And today, I'm proud to say that we will be releasing a book on how to build a learning culture. Volume one is getting released today, and the next 6 months, second volume will be getting released. So certainly you can feel free to ask and get what you want. There is enough resource available, but as Surya said, it's a translation between Bernd's approach and our approach as in Indian culture. So we have now a culture encounter, and we will do that together.
I think the present situation is a classic example of systemic.
Yes.
Because this is something which, there's something which he wants to convey, and I think the entire group is a heterogeneous group. Everybody is from a different background, a different stage of learning, and there is, you know, it's just like an organization. So I think if we can able to solve this, it's a perfect example of
what?
Not just any organization, but it's an Indian organization.
But then the invitation is that how we share responsibility for it. So actually we have at this moment shared some responsibility of me being a part of it, in between checking, and Bernd giving a space for it. In an organization, many times the head of the department or the senior CEO does not give a space for the other person to come in and give an orientation. So here, if you see, this is one model of sharing leadership. At one point, maybe I'm coming in forward as a leadership process, but then I know when to step to the background also. And at this moment, he is stepping background for me to come to the foreground. So this is one way you can also make an intervention in an organization. Is there a free space for people to come to the foreground and go to the background? So we are actually demonstrating what happens in an organization.
So can we deliver these 3 days through this approach? Right, where we...
It depends on, again, context by context. Because I am available throughout here, but Bernd's wisdom is available only when he is here.
No, it could be even burned, but with real life examples where a company has this problem.
That's and wherever necessary, we will co-play. But predominantly, who will be in the limelight is Bernd, because there are wonderful approaches he can give you, because he's going to have some live examples also, which he will do. But wherever necessary to connect, I will be a part of it.
I'm sure Bernd could do it yourself. My suggestion is, can we do this through examples? Like, for example, if you're talking about systemic perspective, can we say, you know, your real-life examples where a company came to you and they had a problem and where you used this technique to solve that
problem? One thing that I asked
in my,
the same question to him
is,
he said, instead of you asking me, you bring your examples. If you bring your example,
we could give you our problems, but we don't know whether it's relevant to the topic that you're talking about, right?
Yeah.
Then we can explore and see, because an experimental approach, we can do that and see.
There are two things. He's right. So I would ask, my teaching style is not explaining everything by prepared examples.
Sure.
My teaching style is giving a sense for principles. We call this deductive learning. From abstraction, we try to understand what the perspectives of these abstractions are, to somehow find attitudes and directions. And then on the other hand, dealing with real problems. And you are right, if you offer me a real problem, then I show you how I try to figure out how this problem could be designed by us together in a dialogue, and I show all the techniques I use to invite you to think about your problem and that we develop something together. But because the priority is on your problem, and this is of thousands of possibility one, we never know in advance whether this will be a demonstration of one of the principles right now. So it's a playing back and forth, and over time, all dimensions are covered by all practical problems. But that's my style. And I never learned, I don't know why, we have teachers who do that, but it's not my style because I'm an inventor and an abstractor. I'm what I can do is making out of experiences programs under how to approach things. So maybe we do kind of combination. You did it so wonderfully, Gisen, to step in and just show you the richness of your experience. And whenever it is afforded, you just do it. It's no point that I just try to do something I have prepared here. What we can do, it's like a mosaic. It's not a systematic rolling out one step after that. We go there, then we might jump there, then we might jump there. And over time, you get a sense of how things are interrelating. My suggestion is, because usually this fills the need and the sense of practically understanding how it's working in action, that in the next step after the lunch break, I do a live learning conversation with one of you. So then, because the reality and how we develop a picture of reality is then evolving from a real example with a real person with its own style and biography and our style and how is this going together in a learning conversations. And then we organize ourselves further from that. So my suggestion would be, is it 12:30?
Yeah,
To have a lunch break now, and please make up your mind who is bringing an example, and then we do a live learning conversations, how I try to use my concepts in understanding the reality of someone else and how I proceed with that. Can we do that?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So have a good lunch.
Thank you.